we had so much fun on New Year's Eve. If you missed that party, whoa, you got to come next year because this was a terrific night. Thank you, Karen Eroldi and her team, for organizing that. It was so great. Woo-hoo! Are you ready to praise God in 2022? Come on, let's get up out of our seats and get ready to praise God Almighty. Yeah.
I won't drown. And when I'm in over my head, I know that you won't let me down. When I'm broken and down to nothing, I know that you are always up to something good. Something good. You make a way, whatever it takes. There's nothing your love won't endure. I know that you are always up to something good. Your love surrounds me, I won't fear. When I'm broken, but when I'm broken and down to nothing, I know that you are always up to something good. I know that you are always up to something good.
How many times in 2021 have you come to our rescue? You're a good, good Father, Lord, and we just thank you and we praise you and we give you the glory you deserve this morning of being a good, 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 good Father.
Deeper still.
And what would it be without the blood this morning? You and I wouldn't be standing here being so free and happy if it wasn't for the blood, right? So let's praise God for the blood.
Bye.
about enough to make you want to dance. All right. Yeah. Wait, I don't know what to say after that. Amen. Turn around to somebody and say, I'm glad you're here today. Happy New Year's to you.
In the kingdom, he did some wonderful things in 2021. And here we are, hearing my voice. Amen. Okay, the Lord loves a cheerful giver. Some of us are blessed to the point where we could give abundantly financially. And some of us have been given other gifts that help as well, like the gift of volunteerism. Yeah? Yes. However, I don't know if PG&E would take volunteers, but here at City Church, we definitely can use volunteers in so many areas. And for those of you who are, all of us are part of the 242 community, the way we thrive is by compiling our resources, whether it's physical, mental, emotional, spiritual, social. We compile our resources, and together we could do a wonderful thing here in the city and out there in the city. Amen? All right. So let's start 2022 out with a big bang. Like we went out with a bang, we're coming in with a big bang. Let's give from the heart. Amen. And I love you all. I want you to know that. That's my gift to you. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Most honorable Father in heaven, we humble ourselves before you. First of all, to say thank you, for you are an awesome God. You are a good, good Father. Lord, we don't even have to ask, because you already know what we need. But we ask, because you said if we ask, we will receive. So Lord, we're asking you to bless us abundantly. We are going to plant seeds in the community to let the world know that you are with us. You are here and you are a wonderful thing, Lord. And we're seeking your love. And may we never cease. In Jesus' name, bless the deposit that we're about to receive. In Jesus' name, may it be used to glorify your kingdom. Amen.
Thank you. All right. Well, we're going to jump right into our text this morning. We're going to be reading from Joel chapter 2, verse 25. I was thinking about this new year and just felt like the Lord has something to say about this coming 2022. And I want to address that here. The title is The Yo-Yo Effect. And I don't know if you've ever played with yo-yos. If you're as old as I am, we grew up with yo-yos. And I went out, actually, I was going to buy a yo-yo online from Amazon. I wanted to show you just how good I am at yo-yo throwing. But I'm old school. I didn't know that there were so many different kinds of yo-yos out right now. I mean, it's crazy. I mean, ones that light up and ones that are big and got all kinds of config. Man, I'm old school. Just give me that simple Duncan yo-yo. And I prefer yellow. And the interesting thing about yo-yos is that once you get the hang of it, the yo-yo always, when you throw it down, it always comes back. Right? Right? All right. When you throw it out, it always comes back to you. As long as it's spinning, it's always on its way back. Well, now, so that's why I said the yo-yo effect, because I believe that in God, there is a yo-yo effect in God. And we read that here in Joel chapter 2, verse 25. The children of Israel have just gone through a horrible, horrible season as a nation. They've fought battles. They've been in captivity. Things just have not gone their way. I mean, it's been a really rough time. They've been devastated as a nation. They've been just absolutely plummeted as a nation. And when they turn to the Lord, when they turn back to God, God says this to them in Joel chapter 2 and verse 25. God says, "I will repay you for the years the locusts have eaten, the great locust, the young locust, the other locust, and the locust swarm." So basically what God is saying is that when you come back to me, speaking to the nation, when you come back to me as a nation, I will restore to you everything that has been taken from you or that has been eaten away. And now the interesting thing here is I like to point out words and within the text, I like to point out sometimes the things that we gloss over or that we miss. And notice here, he says, "I will repay you. I will repay you." And in my Bible, I like to circle things like that. I, not your neighbor, not your relative, not the guy down the street, not your employer, but I will repay you. I will do it. I will repay you. Now, here's the significant part of that, that if you say that you're going to repay me, I can doubt that because it's dependent on your ability, right? So if you have the means and the ability, well, I can halfway trust it as long as you don't have a change of heart midstream. Like if you say, "I'm going to repay you the $100, but when you get the $100, you decide you want to buy something else with it, you're not going to repay me. But it's a different story when God says, "I will repay you." That you can take to the bank, right? I'm going to repay you, not anybody else, but I'm going to repay you. So with that in mind, when we come to Jesus, we all have had things that have been stolen from us or that have been lost. The Bible says that the devil is a thief and a liar. He will not only steal from you, but he'll lie about it while he's doing it. He'll steal from you. You cannot play in the devil's playground without losing stuff. And the longer you play in the devil's playground, the more stuff you will lose. In fact, it goes like this. When you play in the devil's playground and you stay in his playground, the longer you stay, the more you lose. Until you can't lose anything else because he's taken it all from you. And then the last thing he takes is your life. So when you play in the devil's playground, you will lose everything, eventually, even yourself. You'll lose it all. Now, when you come to Jesus, prior to coming to Jesus, you've been playing in the devil's playground. So when you come to Jesus, we've lost stuff like health. There are people here today that you've lost some of your health, some sanity. You've lost relationships. You've lost careers. You've lost possessions. And those things, when you come to the Lord, they're lost. You played in his playground, and he stole them from you, and then he lied about it when he did it. They've been taken from you. And we come to Jesus, and when we come to Jesus, he makes a promise that he's going to restore those things to us. Now, I ask myself, how does God restore what's been taken? How does he do that? He made a promise he would do it. He said, I will restore them. How then does he do that? How does he restore them? Well, the first thing, I've actually come up with two ways. The first way is he does so creatively. He does so creatively. Now, this is how this works. You see, everything about God is creative. If you don't understand that simple fact about God, you will never understand anything about faith or anything about miracles in your life. You have to first understand that God is creative. He's created by nature. He shows us that in Genesis. He says, in the beginning, the earth was without form and void, meaning it was nothingness. And darkness was on the face of the deep. There was nothing there. But God took nothing and he made something. He created from nothing. He created everything that we see from nothing. In fact, he created you from nothing but dust, which equivalently is nothing. He created you with your brain and all of your organs and internal working. You came from dust. And the proof is in death, because you came from dust and dust you will return. Now, when you look at yourself and you think we're all that, man, I've got veins and muscle and a brain and a stomach and digestion system. It's hard for me to comprehend that all of that came from a pile of dust. But it did. And when I die, it's going to go back to dust. But that is the creative power of God. He takes from nothing and he makes something. His creative ability isn't dependent on what you have. It's not dependent on anything about you. He created the sun. He created the moon. He created the stars. He created platypuses, termites, cockroaches, all the things I don't like, lions, tigers, turtles. He created it all from nothing. And then when all of that was done, he decided he would create one more time, and that's you and I. From nothing. Amazing to me. You see, here's the problem. Is that many times, when we're looking at our life, we focus on the issues of our life. And while we're focused on the issues of our life, we think that everything that God is going to do has to happen within something in our life that we can see, feel, touch, hear, know about. But God's not dependent on what you see in your life. He's not dependent on what those things that are there. Because we look for him to use what's there to create. But many times in his creative side, God uses nothing that you have, and he creates outside of you to give you what you don't have, what was stolen from you. So he restores by creating. Half of the miracles that Jesus did were miracles of creation. When Jesus was told that Lazarus was dead, his sister, Lazarus' sister, tried to get Jesus there sooner, but Jesus came late and Lazarus already died. In fact, he had already been put in a tomb. And Jesus said to them, roll away the stone from the tomb. He's not dead. And this is what they told Jesus. They said, Jesus, you don't want to do that because by now he stinks. And if we roll away the stone from the tomb, there's going to be a horrible odor. He was already decomposing, going back to dust. They told Jesus that. It's been so many days now, he's decomposing. Don't roll the stone away. But Jesus said, roll the stone away. And when they removed the stone, he called out to Lazarus and he said, Lazarus, come out of the tomb. At the moment he told Lazarus to come out of the tomb, that which was decomposed all of a sudden came back to life. Creative. That's the creative power of God. He took what was dead and he brought it back to life. And Lazarus came out bound with the wrappings that they used in that day. He could hardly walk out. He was still bound as though he were dead, but Jesus called him back to life. In fact, Jesus then tells those around him, go unwrap him, man. Unwrap him. Get him out of that stuff. He's now alive. When Jesus, he healed the leper. We don't know much about leprosy today because you don't see it. It's not a known disease in our culture. But the studying, the little studying I've done on leprosy, it is nothing you want to get. Your skin literally dies on you to the point that body parts fall off. So if you have leprosy on your face, and it's on your face, eventually your nose will fall off. Your lips will fall off. Your ear may fall off. Things start falling off. If you've got leprosy on your hands, you'll start losing your fingertips. And then it eats its way down your fingers till you have no fingers but nubs. And it's horrible disease, highly contagious. That's why lepers, when they were not allowed to be in public, they had to stay in a colony with other lepers. And when they had to come out in public and they walked down the street, they had to yell out to the people on the street, I'm a leper, I'm a leper, I'm a leper. Get out of my way. Get out, go to the other sidewalk. I'm a leper. Because it's so contagious that if you brush them up against them by mistake, you could contract leprosy. So these lepers call out to Jesus, 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 help us, have mercy on us. It is a slow death leprosy. And Jesus said to them, he's going to heal them. And he touches the leprosy. He touches the dead part on them. And he speaks life to it. Now imagine you're a leper. And the sign of leprosy is as those body parts die, they turn snow white. There's no life in them. There's no blood in them. They turn white. Imagine those watching this, that the leper with no nose and no ears and the other leper with no fingers or part of his arm is gone, eaten away, it's gone, it fell off somewhere. Imagine as Jesus touched the leprosy and said, be healed. The Bible doesn't tell us, but imagine what they were watching. They're watching ears regrow, noses regrow, fingers begin to grow out and extend themselves. They were watching a creative miracle. God working in his creative side, taking from nothing, dead parts, nothing, a no finger, making, boom, a finger. That's the creative side of God. Crippled people. The lame man at the pool of Bethesda said that he had been there for a long time. Jesus healed some crippled people that were crippled from birth. Now, I don't know much about being crippled, but I do know this, that when your leg is deformed and muscles are deformed and you can't walk, that in order to be healed, something new has to happen. Something brand new has to happen. And when Jesus healed those that were crippled, he creatively made something happen that they didn't have at all before. Blind people came to Jesus. And in some cases, he made mud and put mud in their eyes. And many people have wondered, why did Jesus put mud in their eyes? Well, this is what I believe. I believe that the blind person, their eyes were so deteriorated, they couldn't be healed. They couldn't be healed. They had to be recreated. And from dirt you came, dirt you'll go back. Jesus said, well, I made you from scratch from dirt. I'll take a little bit of mud and I'll just create a new eyeball in you. And he spat in the dirt and he made some mud and he went and he put it on the guy's eyes. He said, now go wash it up and you'll see. He created from nothing. I don't know, maybe the guy had no eye and he made a brand new eye. Maybe his eye was so deteriorated. We don't know how he went blind. The text does not tell us. Other than he was blind. And God created. So what happens in your life? You see, there are things in your life that have been completely taken. I mean, when you look at it, you think God can't heal it because it's gone completely. It's nowhere around anymore. It's not there to be healed. But that doesn't limit God. Because God doesn't need it to be there to restore it. He can make it anew. We limit God when we think he's restricted to what we have. But he's not restricted to what you have. The creative side of God can make from absolutely nothing something. Well, Lord, you don't understand. When I was out there, I mean I lost this and I lost that and I'll never get it back. Well, let the creative side of God get working, and you might be absolutely amazed with what he gives back. Because he said in Joel, he said, I will repay you. I will restore it. I will give it back. It's coming back. I believe this. I believe that God, in his foreknowledge, he looks at our life and he sees you running amok. But he also sees a date and time that you're going to wise up, get smart, and give your life to Jesus. And he's got it on the calendar. He's got it on the calendar of your life. So-and-so running amok for 5 years, but in the fifth year, he's going to wise up, go to City Church, and give his life to Jesus. And he's got it on the calendar. So year one, this is taken from you. Lost wife and kids. Year two, lost job. Year three, lost some of his sanity. Year four, man, he better come to Jesus quick. He's losing it all. And he's taking note of everything you lost because he plans on repaying it. And when you give your life to Jesus, he immediately begins to repay it. He does so creatively. I've seen God do things in my life. I prayed the prayer, God, fix it. But in my heart, I said, there is absolutely no way to fix it. But he went outside of my understanding, did something supernaturally to fix it, and then blew my mind because it wasn't in my parameter of what's fixable. The second way that God restores, he restores that which is broken. Now, there are those things, let's break it into two categories. There are those things that are stolen, meaning if I take something from you, I steal something from you, you no longer have it. I got it. In order for you to get it back, God's got to create a new one for you. Because I got what you had, and you ain't getting it back. You see, so there are things that we've lost that God has to create a new one for you. A new one. Not the old one, but a new one. So if you've lost your job because you did some crazy stuff on the job in the day, God isn't necessarily going to get you back into that place of employment, but he'll create a new one for you. A new one. And usually when he creates a new one, it's better than the old one. I can testify to that. Anytime God creates a new one, it's better than what you had. So I love it when he creates new stuff, because it's far better than the old stuff I had. But what about the stuff that's broken that you still have, that's broken? What about the relationship that's broken? It's not gone. It's just broken. You still have it. It's broken. And you're living with brokenness because of some of the things in the past. So God restores creatively, but God also restores by fixing that which is broken. In fact, when you look at the word restoration, the word restoration simply means to restore and to make new again. Restore and to make new again. So what God does is God takes that which is broken, not lost, not stolen, but broken, that which is broken, and he begins to restore it, to make it new again. So that would be like relationships. That would be self-esteem, your self-esteem that has been broken. You still have self-esteem. It's just the wrong type. But he's going to fix that which is broken. What about emotional well-being? What about emotional well-being? He's going to fix the emotions that have been destroyed. And he'll restore them back to the factory setting of when he created you. He'll do a reset. I believe with all of my heart that people that have had addictions for any length of time and have burned brain cells, I believe God fixes that. I believe that with all of my heart. I have seen it happen too many times to not believe that. And people that just succumb to, well, I've got mental issues, I've got emotional issues. People that just succumb to that with, well, that's just the way life is going to be. Shame on you, because you're limiting God from restoring that which is broken. I come from a a culture back in the day that used drugs that you don't see much today, but they were mind-destroying drugs. And I ran with a group of people that many of the group that I ran with had lost half their mind. In fact, my best friend came from a mental institution. We got him out of the mental institution. He had totally lost his mind. He was a fruitcake. And I've told his story before, but he's an absolute fruitcake. And they had given up on him. Just keep him medicated. And we said, no. God can do something in his name. And we got him out of that hospital, and we brought him back, and he was a goofhead. I'm telling you, he couldn't do anything but sit on a stool and spit at you. And we put him on a stool in the corner, and we stayed out of the range of spit because he was pretty good at hawking one at you. And we kept our distance, but we didn't know what to do. We're Christians, didn't know anything. I mean, we're just stupid. We didn't know anything. Not like Christians today, they're all sophisticated. We just said, well, you know, we don't know what to do with. We didn't know anything about counseling. We know that they prescribe heavy medications, but we said you don't need to take those anymore. God's going to just heal you. Yeah, oh, he better heal him because he's getting crazier, right? You know what we did? We told somebody to read the Bible to him all day. When you get tired, get somebody else to read the Bible to him. That's all we knew to do. If God's word is powerful and it creates, read the Bible to him. Start at Genesis. Just read it to him. After a day or two, he stopped spitting. Couple days later, he was talking. We didn't know he could talk. He's talking to us. A few days later, he's out running around with us. And eventually, he got a job. And I got a job. And guess who was my boss? He was. I'm like, dude, you were crazy in the day. I read to you the Bible. You're my boss? He went on to marry, have children, and go to college. The guy that was in the mental institution. Don't tell me God can't heal people's minds. Your job, if you're here and you have a problem, your job is to follow Jesus with all your heart. That's your job. You let him do his job. You just follow him. You get in his word. You stay in fellowship with him. That's your job. Focus on your job. It's not that hard. It's 1, 2, 3. Read his word. Stay in prayer. Keep him involved in your life. You do your job and you let him do his job because he said he would do it. And he will restore that which is broken. See, sometimes we have relationships that are broken or physical health that has been severely damaged. And we look at those things and we look at them asking, how God, can you fix this? Because we think we want to know how it's going to get fixed. How, God, can you fix this? But God doesn't think like you think. God has a way of restoring relationships and physical illnesses and mental problems. He has a way of fixing it in a way that you don't know. If you go and cut your finger today, you got a nice cut on your finger, and it's bleeding. And what do you see? You see your finger and you see the blood. That's all you see, right? So what do when that happens? We clean the wound and we put a Band-Aid on it. And we try to forget about it, except for when we bump it and they go, ow. But we try to forget about it. The Band-Aid's there. We no longer have to look at the cut. The Band-Aid's hiding it. The Band-Aid's not healing the cut. It's being healed from inside your body. You've got all kinds of things happening in your body that are running to stop the bleeding, that are starting to close the womb up. You don't see it. And then one day you take the band-aid off, you go, oh, wow, it's almost gone. We usually don't stop to think how that happened, because we know we would never understand it unless you were in the medical field and you had all that knowledge. We just accept the fact that we put the band-aid on, 5 days later, take the band-aid off, looks pretty good to me. Stop trying to figure out how God is going to restore what's broken. Let him do his job. You in faith expect him to do it. But it's when we start trying to dissect, well, you Lord, I believe you're going to restore my relationship. But when I called them, they hung up on me and they called me a name. It wasn't a good name. It was a really dirty name. They called me a name. I don't see how you're going to do that. It's not your problem how he does it. Just believe he will do it and let him do what he does. We spend all of our time trying to figure it out, that we actually talk. Do you know that when you start doing that and you start being all believing that God can't, it's almost as though you stop the hand of God. God works in faith. He doesn't work in unbelief. And you just put a screeching halt on what he's doing, because it's as though God is saying, well, if you don't believe I can fix it, well, then I guess I won't. But don't figure it out. Just let him do it. In John chapter 14, in verse 27, I'm going to leave you with this. Jesus said, I leave the gift of peace with you. My peace. And then he qualifies it. He says, not the kind of fragile peace given by the world, but my perfect peace. Okay? Let's stop for a minute. Again, you pick up on, I like to focus on words, right? Notice the word leave. Did you pick up on that? I leave the gift of peace with you. Right? I leave the gift of peace with you. We just had Christmas. And some of us got gifts. Yeah, I know. I had to wear it today because I know I look good. So some of us, we got gifts, right? So if I gave you a gift at Christmas time in a nice bag and I said, here's your gift. I did exactly what Jesus did. I leave the gift of peace with you. I left it with you. It's your gift. I left it with you. Open it. Now, if you received that gift of peace and you took it and you went home with it, but you never opened it, you never took it out of the bag or the wrapping, you never got to enjoy it because you didn't take it out. Okay. Listen carefully. We don't have to pray for peace. When Jesus said, I leave you the gift of peace, my peace, he already gave it to you. He already gave it to you. You don't need to go, God, give me peace. Oh, God, help me to not to worry. He already gave it to you. He said, I leave you the gift of peace. I already gave it to you. It's yours. Your job, my job, is to open the package and take it out. My job is when I'm feeling those feelings of despair, My job is to say, I'm taking your peace now, Jesus. Not the kind that's in the world that's fragile or given by the world. Not that peace, because that's temporary. That's based on the situation. But I'm taking your peace, because he said, I give you the gift of peace. My peace I'm giving you. My peace, which is supernatural. My peace I'm giving you. I take that now and I receive it. And I'm going to act upon it. And it's that peace that overrides all fear. Now, he goes on to say, don't yield to fear or be troubled in your heart. Don't yield to fear or be troubled in your heart. Why is that significant? Because when we come to Jesus, there's a certain amount of damage that has happened by playing in the devil's play yard. And you can try to cover it up with nice clothes and some nice stuff, but deep down, you know what the damage is. And to the extent of the damage, other people know what the damage is also. But sometimes when we focus on the damage, when we focus on that which we lost, when we focus on that which is broken, what do? We do what Jesus said not to do. He said, don't yield to fear or be troubled in your hearts. Don't yield to fear or be troubled in your hearts. Because sometimes when you begin to think about that, the fear and the trouble can be overwhelming to the extent that it clouds you from seeing what God can do. It clouds you from seeing what God is doing. It's almost as though you put sunglasses on that are a little too dark and you're in a dark room and you can't see really clear. Our job is not to yield to fear. Our job is to be courageous. Our job is to be courageous. We don't live in denial. That wouldn't be courageous, would it? To live in denial is a sissy way out. But courageous people own what's happened. Yeah, I've had stuff stolen. Yeah, I have stuff that's broken. Yeah, I've done some stupid stuff in my life. But you know what? That was then. This is now. This is now. And right now, God is restoring. Right now, God took inventory of all the things that were stolen from me. He took care of all. He has an inventory of all the things that are broken. He knows about it. I don't have to remind him. He's been keeping records since the day I was born. It goes all the way back to when I was born. There is stuff stolen from me and broken in me before I could make up my own decisions. Some of you that have parents that have done that to you, it's not your fault, but it happens. It happened. But we don't have to live with that. Because when we come to Christ, he has an inventory of all that happened. And he begins to restore creatively. And sometimes restoring what is broken and is there, he makes it whole again. He creates and he makes whole. And we just have to let him do it. What makes 2022 so exciting? Ask yourself, what is he going to restore in your life this year? What is he going to recreate in your life this year. What is he going to do? If you are here New Year's Eve, I shared with everybody, this is a time where you need to sit for a minute and not necessarily reflect on the old, but position yourself and ask God, what's he going to do in the new? Because as you do that, what are you doing? You're looking with faith. What are you doing in the new? And that opens the door for God to begin to do that in your life. And your next year will be far better than your last year. Just because you failed in 2021 doesn't mean you're going to fail in 2022. Don't let the devil tell you that. Remember, he's a liar and he's a thief. He will always entice you to play in his playground again. Because that's the only way he can steal from you, is if you agree to play in his playground. But don't listen to those lies. Because God said, I will restore what the locusts have eaten. I will do it. Let me do what I do. You know, I've asked the worship team to come because I want to close today. I want to close in a song. I want them to lead a song. I've been singing it since I wrote these notes in my iPad. I've been singing it. Even when I don't see he's working, he's still working. And I want to close with that song, and Pastor LT will then come and pray us out.
I worship you. You are. Even when I don't see it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. Do it again. way maker, way maker, way maker, way maker, way maker, way maker, way maker. Yes, yes. Look, this is, I'm going to pray out, but this is 2022, right? Now, I'm going to say it's, I'm glad to see you. Right. And then you say, it's good to be seen. Good to see you. Yes, yes. That in itself is showing God has made a way. That he's a miracle worker and that he's a promise keeper. Amen? Yeah, so we have so much to be thankful for. We have so much to be grateful for. Right? When we think about it, we don't know how we got here, but we did. Right? And it's all because of what? His grace, his mercy. And I tell you, the most important thing is because he loves us so much. He loves us so much that we just got to understand that when we realize that God loves us and that he's with us and that he'll never leave us nor forsake us, we don't have anything to worry about. We don't have anything to be afraid of. Right? Because when we don't see him working, he is working. Amen? So we got to know that. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Yes. Heavenly Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you for your grace and we thank you for your mercy. We thank you for loving us, Father. But most of all, Father, we thank you for who you are. Father, you are the creator of heaven and earth, the unseen and seen, Father. You are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the ending, Father. Father, it's not about us, it's all about you. Father, we glorify you, we magnify you, Father, and we exalt you, Father. And Father, we thank you, Father. We thank you, Father, for loving us, Father, and caring for us, Father, and providing and protecting us, Father. And Father, as we bring in this new year, as we bring in this new year, Father, we want to just enter into your rest, Father. We enter into your rest, Father, and we want you, Father, to erase all unbelief, Father, and let us know, Father, that we can trust you. And as we acknowledge you, Father, we won't lean on our own understanding, Father. Father, what we're going to do, we're going to come out the devil's playground, Father, we're not going back into the devil's playground, Father. And Father, right now, we trust you with all our heart. We lean not to our own understanding. We acknowledge you in all our ways, Father. And we thank you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Someone who has it worse than you. Sometimes you gotta pay your dues. So don't worry, just push on through. Keep it in reverse.